हेलो,
हेलो,
आवाज आ रही
मेरा
है?
नाम निशा आर्या। हाँ, ओके ओके।
ओके ओके ओके। अस्सलाम वालेकुम एंड अ वेरी गुड आफ्टरनून टू यू ऑल। सॉरी फॉर द डिले, देयर वाज अ प्रॉब्लम इन कनेक्शन। एनीवेज, टुडे टॉपिक ऑफ माय लेक्चर टुडे इज द डिजेनरेटिव डिजीज ऑफ द डिजीजेस ऑफ द बेसल गैंग्लिया, मेनली पार्किंसन। वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस पार्किंसोनिज्म एंड ब्रेन स्टेम्स। सो वी विल डिस्कस द डिजेनरेटिव डिजीजेस। ओके, सो what is Parkinson? Parkinson is a neurodegenerative disease of the brain that is caused by a loss of dopaminergic neurons from the substantia nigra. Neurons which are present in the substantia nigra, dopamine is the neurotransmitter. So there'll be loss of those neurons, and there'll be difficulty in transmission of impulses. Okay, now what is substantia nigra? Substantia nigra is a region in the midbrain that is considered to be a part of the basal ganglia. This is substantia nigra in the midbrain, and it is a part of basal ganglia. There'll be loss of dopaminergic neurons in the substantia nigra in this disease. As a result, what is this? It is a darkened streak in unstained brain. When you cut a section of the midbrain, you will see substantia nigra as a darkened streak. And this substantia nigra, the word substantia nigra is derived from the Latin word which means black substance. Because when you take the cross-sectional area of the midbrain, you see these black streaks in the midbrain, and this is called as substantia nigra. That there are actually two substantia nigri, one on each side of the midbrain. Okay, so there'll be loss of dopaminergic neurons of the substantia nigra as a result of neurodegeneration. Okay, and this results in Parkinson disease. As a result of this Parkinson disease, it is characterized by, what are the clinical symptoms? They'll be hypokinetic. Hypokinetic means decreased movement will be present in the body of the patient. And several other neurodegenerative diseases include symptoms of Parkinson. Not only Parkinson disease have these sign and symptoms, but also other neurodegenerative diseases in which there is loss of dopaminergic neurons in any other part of the brain, there'll be symptoms like Parkinson. Okay, and these types of motor disturbance, why this is motor? This is not sensory, this is only motor, because it is related to movement, is seen in a number of conditions in which there is a damage to the substantia nigra dopaminergic system. Okay, so there'll be motor losses, there'll be decrease in the movement in this disorder. And why this decrease in the movement? Because there's loss of dopaminergic neurons, nerves which secretes dopamine as a neurotransmitter, they'll be lost. And in Parkinson, they'll be lost from the substantia nigra. And as a result, there'll be decreased movement in the body. Now, as a result, what are the clinical syndrome of Parkinson? What happen is that in Parkinson, there'll be decreased facial expressions because there'll be loss of dopaminergic neurons in the substantia nigra. So it will look like a mask face. The patient will have decreased facial expression. What will be the other symptoms clinically? There'll be a stooped posture. Can you see a bending posture, stooped posture? And there'll be slowing of the voluntary movements. Whenever the patient wants to perform anything, there'll be slowing of that movement. Bradykinesia it is also called. And there'll be fascinating gait. If you put this fascinating gait on the Google, you can see that there'll be progressive shortened steps in these patients. There'll be rigidity in the body because there'll be, as a result, there'll be decreased movement, and there'll be tremors present in the patient. So these five things, if you see clinically in a patient, you can suspect that this patient is probably suffering from Parkinson syndrome or any neurodegenerative disease. What will be the five features? There'll be diminished facial expressions, and you can, in other words, you can also call, they will have mask face. They will not give, they will give, they will be unable to give good expressions on their face. There'll be stooped posture, bending posture, slowing of the voluntary movement because there'll be rigidity in the body because of the loss of dopaminergic neurons in the substantia nigra. So there'll be slowing of the voluntary movement. Voluntary movement says that if a person wants to perform any task, any work, they'll be unable to perform, or if they will be able to perform, they will perform it very slowly because of the rigidity in the body. There'll be fascinating gait. When these patients walk, they will walk with progressive shortened accelerated steps. Okay, and there'll be tremors, pill rolling tremors in the hand, like the rolling pill, okay, tablet, like the rolling tablet, there'll be pill rolling tremors in the body. So if you see clinically these five signs and symptoms, you suspect that this patient is probably suffering from Parkinson disease. Now, Parkinson disease, similar symptoms may be pharmacologically induced. These symptoms, like Parkinson-like symptoms, can also be produced by certain chemicals, toxins, and even medication and drugs, which have a which damages the dopaminergic system. So, see, these symptoms can be seen. Otherwise, also, if the patient is not suffering from Parkinson disease, but they're taking certain medication or drugs, or they're exposed to certain chemicals or toxins that damages the dopaminergic neurons of the substantia nigra. Now, it is a principal degenerative disease that involves the nigrostriatal system. Parkinson involves the dopaminergic neurons of the nigrostriatal symptoms, but these Parkinson-like symptoms can also be produced by certain drugs and chemicals. So, and other rare diseases also, we are going to discuss in coming slides, other rare diseases of the brain which have Parkinson-like clinical features. Okay, now, central triad, if a triad of clinical symptoms are present in a patient, then you suspect that this patient is, the first thing which should come in your mind is should be that the patient has a Parkinson disease. That patient will have tremors, pill rolling tremors. The body will have rigidity, and they'll be rigid because of the rigidity in the body, because of the loss of dopaminergic neurons. They'll be bradykinesia. Brady means slow, and kinesia means kinetic, means movement. There'll be slow movement in their body. In the absence of, if the patient is not taking any drug, any medication, or is not exposed to any chemical or toxin, then you should suspect that this patient is suffering from Parkinson disease. Otherwise, there are certain toxins and certain drugs which have a function of dopaminergic antagonist, and they inhibit the neurotransmitter dopamine, and they will produce Parkinson-like symptoms. This impression is confirmed. This is confirmed by the symptomatic response. And these patients, when given L-DOPA, which is an immediate precursor, it is a medication, L-DOPA, that is the immediate precursor of dopamine neurotransmitter, which is then converted to dopamine in the brain. And when you give this as a medication and the patient's symptoms improve, then you suspect that this patient was suffering from Parkinson disease. Now, Parkinson disease is not restricted to dopaminergic neurons or to the basal ganglia. It will not restrict itself. This disease will not restrict itself to the neuron. It starts in the basal ganglia, in the substantia nigra, by the loss of neurons which secrete the neurotransmitter dopamine. But it will not be restricted to the basal ganglia, but it will also extend to the cerebral cortex, and it will lead to cognitive impairment. What are cognitive impairment? Learning new things. Patient will have difficulty in learning new things, in concentrating, and in judgment. Okay, so this will not limit itself. This disease of Parkinson will not limit itself to the basal ganglia and degeneration of the neurons of the substantia nigra, but it will also extend to the cerebral cortex and will affect other functions also, like learning new things, concentrating, focusing, and judgment. Okay, then severity of the motor symptoms is proportional to the dopamine deficiency. The more the dopamine deficiency in Parkinson disease, the more severe the symptoms will be, which can at least in parts be corrected. And it can be in the initial stages, it can be corrected by the replacement therapy of L-DOPA. L-DOPA is the immediate precursor of dopamine. So it is converted to dopamine. If this medication is given L-DOPA, it will be converted to dopamine, and the deficiency of dopamine will be overcome, and the patient symptoms will improve initially. Drugs therapy tend to become less effective with time. With time, as the disease becomes more severe, then this L-DOPA drug therapy will become less effective, and the symptoms become more difficult to manage as the disease becomes severe. Treatment does not reverse this treatment with L-DOPA. It will not reverse the structural changes which has already occurred in the brain, that is the neurodegeneration of the dopaminergic neurons. This will not reverse, this treatment will not reverse, only improve symptoms, but it will not reverse the structural changes which have already occurred in the brain or arrest, and it will not even stop the progression of the disease to the other parts of the brain, but it will only improve symptoms for time being. Okay, but it will not stop the disease from progression also. So now there's a chemical which is known as MPTP, that is 1-methyl-4-phenyl-1,2,3,6-tetrahydropyridine, discovered as a contaminant. This chemical is present in the opioid meperidine. opioids are the painkillers which are taken by patients, obviously, and they can cause acute Parkinson's syndrome and cause destruction of the neurons of substantia nigra when this chemical is taken. So you should take the history from the patient that whether he or she is taking some opioid, bupivacaine, which has this toxin 1-methyl-4-phenyl-1,2-3,6 tetrahydropyridine, which can cause Parkinson's disease. And acute Parkinson's disease, it can precipitate by destruction because this chemical can destroy the neurons, dopaminergic neurons of the substantia nigra, and will lead to Parkinson-like symptoms, that is tremors, bradykinesia, there'll be slowing rigidity, slowing of the movement. Epidemiological evidence suggests that pesticide exposure in farmers and patients, a person who work in a chemical industry, have a risk of developing this Parkinson disease because these chemicals, he may be exposed to this MPTP, that's 1-methyl-4-phenyl-1,2-3,6 tetrahydropyridine. So you have to take when you're taking the history, you should take the history of opioids, bupivacaine, and you should also ask that what is the profession, whether he or she works in a chemical industry or is a farmer and exposed to pesticides. On the other hand, caffeine and nicotine has a protective effect in Parkinson's disease because this stimulates the neurons of the brain, isn't it? Now, molecular genetics. What is the molecular genetics? Parkinson's disease is associated with protein accumulation and aggregation, and it is also associated with mitochondrial. There'll be accumulation of certain protein in the nerves, okay? And there'll be mitochondrial abnormality. When checked at the molecular level, it was found out that there's accumulation of certain proteins in the neurons, which causes their neurodegeneration. There's some mitochondrial abnormality and neuronal loss in the substantia nigra and also other parts of the brain. While most Parkinson's disease are rare, series of genetic causes have been identified, although it is rare, but scientists have found out that there are some genetic predisposition also to this disease. Okay, now first gene to be identified as a cause of autosomal molecule at the molecular level, the first gene which was identified is autosomal dominant Parkinson disease is alpha synuclein. This is the name of the gene and an abundant lipid binding protein. And this mutation in the alpha synuclein is rare, and this is point mutation or amplification of the region of 4q21, chromosome 4q, short arm of the chromosome 21, that contains genes, this alpha synuclein gene, and will produce alpha synuclein protein, and this protein will aggregate in the neurons and will result in the neurodegeneration. This protein is a major component of Lewy bodies. Now this protein will accumulate in the neuron in the form of Lewy bodies, which is a diagnostic hallmark of Parkinson's disease. When biopsy of these neurodegenerative neurons were done, it was found out that this alpha synuclein, there's a mutation in the alpha synuclein gene, maybe a point mutation or amplification of this gene, which led to the accumulation of a lipid binding protein alpha synuclein in the neurons, lead to neurodegeneration. And they accumulate in the form of Lewy body in the neurons. Now, alpha synuclein form aggregates that appears to be more toxic to the neurons. Alpha synuclein contain aggregates in the form of Lewy bodies and Lewy neuritis and will lead to inflammation of the neurons. First appear in the medulla and then it spreads to the other areas of the brain, ascending through the brainstem and extending into the limbic system and finally involves the neocortex. That is, it does not limit itself to the basal ganglia, but it will spread to the other parts of the brain also, and it will affect the functions of the body. Now, in autosomal recessive, alpha synuclein gene is autosomal dominant mutation, but autosomal recessive mutations of Parkinson's disease are also present, which leads to mitochondrial dysfunction and act as a contributing factors. It was also being found out that there are some autosomal mutations also, which will lead to mitochondrial dysfunction and will lead to the sign and symptoms of Parkinson's disease caused by the mutation in the genes that encodes protein DJ1. PINK1 and PARKIN1. DJ1 has a multicellular load. This is a protein, okay? DJ1 protein. PINK1 is also a protein, and PARKIN1. They are all involved in autosomal recessive Parkinson's disease. DJ1 has a multiple cellular role. When this is mutated, what happens is it performs the function transcriptional regulator and also has a cytoprotective effect. But when this gene is mutated, it will not perform its normal function and will lead to Parkinson's disease. Okay, now under normal circumstances also, combination of PINK1 gene and PARKIN1 results in the clearance of dysfunctional, not properly functioning mitochondria from the brain. But when this gene is mutated, it will not perform its normal function and can also lead to Parkinson's disease. Okay, now there's another gene known as leucine-rich repeated kinase 2. The symbol is LRRK2, is a cytoplasmic kinase, which mutation of this gene are more common causes of autosomal dominant. Now, there are two autosomal dominant causes, that is mutation in the alpha synuclein gene, and the other is the mutation in the leucine-rich repeated kinase 2. It results in the autosomal dominant form. That is, even if one gene is defective, then the patient will suffer from the disease, are found in some sporadic rare cases of the Parkinson's disease. This mutation was found out. Now, several of the pathognomic mutations increases the kinase activity. Now, what happens is when there's a mutation in this leucine-rich repeated kinase 2, there'll be increased kinase activity, suggesting the gain of LRRK function might contribute to the development of Parkinson's disease. So at the molecular level, it was found out that there can be mutation in several genes which can lead to the development of Parkinson's disease. Now, morphologically, when you see a cut section of the brain of the patient with substantia Parkinson's disease, what you will see is that, you know, this is the cut section of a midbrain, and you can see the pallor of substantia nigra and locus coeruleus, which is due to loss of pigment. They'll be in your, normally this is like this pigmentation. Now, this is in patients with Parkinson's disease, there will be loss of this pigmentation. Why loss of pigmentation occur? Because of the catecholamine neuron in this region, which has given this pigmentation. But in Parkinson's disease, there will be loss of this black pigmented area. Okay, in patients of Parkinson's, this is a normal midbrain cross section, and this is abnormal. This is the cross sectional area of the midbrain of the patient who is suffering from Parkinson's disease. Okay, under the, you can see it when this is taken out. Achha, morphologically, under the microscope, what you see is Lewis bodies may be found in some of the regions of the neurons. These Lewis bodies can be single or multiple cytoplasmic, present within the cytoplasmic, because they are pinkish. Eosinophilic means pinkish in color, round or sometimes elongated inclusion that have a dense core surrounded by a pale halo around. Okay, so these are the Lewis bodies, which occur as a result of accumulation of a protein known as alpha synuclein. This is a microscopic picture which is taken. You can see Lewis bodies when only microscopic picture is taken, and this is the neuron of a Lewis body seen in the neuron of a patient who's suffering from Parkinson's disease. Now, ultrastructurally, Lewis bodies are composed of fine filaments. This Lewis body contains fine filaments, if you see under the ultrastructural microscope, and dense packed core. It has a dense packed core, that is, center is very densely packed with these filaments, fine filaments, and there's a loose rim at the peripheries. These filaments are composed of alpha synuclein, which is a protein. Because of the mutation of the alpha synuclein gene, there'll be accumulation of this protein, which will lead to neurodegeneration of the dopaminergic neurons of the substantia nigra. Now, areas of neuronal loss also typically shows gliosis. Gliosis is the inflammation of the surrounding structures other than the neurons in the brain. It will also lead to gliosis. Now, dementia. Now, Parkinson's disease, we have done, is one of the most common popular degenerative disease of the basal ganglia. Now, what are the other degenerative diseases of the basal ganglia? Dementia with Lewy bodies. About 10 to 15% of the individual with Parkinson's disease develop dementia, particularly with the advancing age. With old age patients, about 10 to 15% of the individual who are suffering from Parkinson's disease also develop dementia. Characteristic feature of this disorder includes fluctuating course. It is not a continuous course, it is fluctuating, and the patient will have hallucinations also, and prominent frontal signs also. Now, we will not go into the detail of prominent frontal signs. You can do it later, but the patient will suffer from hallucination and prominent frontal signs. We will say that this Parkinson's disease patient, about 10 to 15% of the patient who are suffering from Parkinson's disease also develop dementia. Dementia with Lewy bodies, what happen is that when their biopsy is done, when such patient's biopsy is done, their neurons shows Lewy body may represent an advanced stage of the Parkinson's disease in which protein aggregates through the propagation of. Now, what happen is this is an advanced stage of a Parkinson's disease when the patient develops dementia, because the Parkinson's disease will will extend to the cerebral cortex, and the patient will have symptoms of dementia also. And it occurs only in 10 to 15% of the patient. Cortical Lewy, cortical is within the cerebral cortex. Lewy's bodies are less distinct than those observed in the brainstem. In the brainstem neurons, you will see more prominent Lewy's bodies as compared to cortex, but are composed of predominantly, both of them will contain alpha-synuclein protein. Acha, on cross-sectional area when done, immunohistochemical staining is done of these alpha-synuclein, reveals the presence of abnormal neurites. Neurites are the projection which are coming out of the cell body of the neuron that contain aggregation of proteins, and they are known as Lewy neuritis. Okay, because these neurites that are the projections coming from the cell body of the neuron, they contain alpha-synuclein. Pathological findings typically includes depigmentation of the substantia nigra. I've already shown you the picture that the substantia nigra will be depigmented and locus ceruleus, and paired with the relative preservation of cortex, hippocampus and amygdala, they will be preserved. Cortex, hippocampus, amygdala, they'll be saved, but there'll be depigmentation of substantia nigra and locus ceruleus in patients who are suffering from Parkinson's disease and develop dementia with Lewy bodies. Now, there's another type of Parkinson's syndrome, which is known as atypical, which is not typical. Okay. Now, clinical syndrome of Parkinson with bradykinesia, the patient will have bradykinesia. Brady means slow. Kinesia is the kinetic, that is movement, slow movement and rigidity. Their body will have slow movements and rigidity, reflects dysfunction of extrapyramidal circuit, particularly dopaminergic neurostriatal projections. Okay, they will be, it will be atypical. It will not be a typical Parkinson disease. It will be a atypical Parkinson disease in which the patient will have bradykinesia and rigidity, which reflects that the dysfunction of the pyramidal, extrapyramidal circuits, particularly dopaminergic nigrostriatal projection. There are variety of disorders, which includes Parkinson as a component of symptoms. They will have other, but they will have Parkinson-like symptoms also. So these diseases are minimally responsive to. So they are the diseases who will respond very little or will not respond to L-DOPA treatment. If it's a exclusively a Parkinson disease, then the patient symptoms and sign will improve at the initial stages with L-DOPA therapy. But if there are other diseases or atypical Parkinson, it will not improve with L-DOPA therapy. They are also distinguished from Parkinson disease through the presence of additional sign, and they will have some additional sign and symptoms also other than bradykinesia, rigidity and tremors. They will have other sign and symptoms also. So you will say that it is some other disease other than Parkinson, but it also includes Parkinson-like symptoms. So it is known as atypical Parkinson syndrome. Now, they are known as atypical Parkinson syndrome or Parkinson plus syndrome, because they will have Parkinson-like symptoms and they will have some other symptoms also. These diseases, the name of such diseases are progressive supranuclear palsy, corticobasal degeneration, and multisystem atrophy. You know, we are going to discuss briefly these three types, but they're given in detail in Robbins. So you, at your level, you know, in the lecture, we can only discuss briefly, but you have to learn it in detail from the Robbins. Okay. Now, what is progressive supranuclear palsy? It's an atypical Parkinson syndrome. Causative mutation is tau gene, have been identified in only few cases. The cause, you know, that is a tau gene mutation has been identified in only few cases of progressive supranuclear palsy. Risk of sporadic progressive supranuclear palsy is linked to single nucleotide polymorphism. And they've seen that either mutation in the tau gene is observed in progressive supranuclear palsy, or there is some single nucleotide polymorphism that is present near the tau gene locus position. Near the tau gene position, there's some single nucleotide polymorphism that results in progressive supranuclear palsy. Now, progressive supranuclear palsy is a tauopathy because it involves the tau gene, so it is called as tauopathy. In that, affected individual commonly develops progressive truncal rigidity. There'll be progressive truncal rigidity. There'll be disequilibrium. That is why when the patient tries to walk, he or she will have frequent falls, and there'll be difficulty in voluntary eye movement. Truncal rigidity is the patient will unable to move its trunk here and there. There'll be difficulty when the patient is walking, he or she will fall because of the disequilibrium, and there'll be difficulty in voluntary eye movement. When the eye tries to move here and there, to see here and there, patient will have difficulty. Other symptoms which are included in progressive supranuclear palsy are nuchal dystonia, pseudobulbar palsy, and mild progressive dementia. So these are the six symptoms which are present in patients with progressive supranuclear palsy. So if these are present, then you suspect that patient is not suffering from Parkinson's disease, but progressively, probably from progressive supranuclear palsy. Morphologically, if you do the biopsy of the patient who's suffering from progressive supranuclear palsy, what you will see, there'll be widespread neuronal loss in the globus pallidus, in the subthalamic nuclei, in the substantia nigra, there'll be loss of neurons. So, you know, it also involves the Parkinson-like symptoms, but other symptoms will also be present. Colliculi will be present, periaqueductal gray matter, and dentate nucleus of the cerebellum, there'll be loss of neurons from all these areas, that is from the globus pallidus, from the subthalamic nuclei, from substantia nigra, colliculi, periaqueductal gray matter, dentate nucleus of the cerebellum. As a result, this disease occurs, and sign and symptoms what were the sign and symptoms? Truncal rigidity, disequilibrium with frequent falls, difficulty in eye movement, pseudobulbar palsy, nuclear dystonia, and mild progressive dementia will occur in these patients. Now, they will be present of neuronal loss. There'll be fibrillary tangles will be present in these affected region in the neuron as well as in the glia. Obviously, when a histopathologist look at the biopsy, they will be able to diagnose. They will be able to see this neurofibrillary tangles. They will be able to see this neuronal loss in the different areas of the brain, and they will diagnose that a patient is probably suffering from progressive supranuclear palsy. When you see under the microscope, it reveals that 15 nanometer straight filaments that are composed of tau. Tau is a protein. So there'll be these filaments present in these areas, which are responsible for the neuronal loss and also for the formation of fibrillary tangles. Okay, these are, when you see under the microscope, you see these changes in the brain. Now, there's another atypical Parkinson's syndrome, which is known as corticobasal degeneration. What is corticobasal degeneration? It's a progressive tauopathy. It's also a tauopathy that is most often characterized by extrapyramidal rigidity, asymmetric motor. Motor means movement disturbances, like jerky movements of the limb of the patient, impaired higher cortical function, typically in the form of aparaxis. Okay, as with progressive supranuclear palsy, corticobasal degeneration, cognitive decline will also occur. The patient will also have difficulty in learning new things, concentrating, focusing on something, and making judgments may occur typically later in the illness of corticobasal degeneration. It also occurs in Parkinson's disease, this cognitive decline. It also occurs in progressive supranuclear palsy, and it also is seen in patients with corticobasal degeneration. Same as a tau variant linked to PSP is also highly associated with this corticobasal. That is why they come under the category of atypical Parkinson's syndrome. Okay, now corticobasal degeneration and progressive supranuclear palsy, these two diseases shares many clinical and pathological features, but they will not respond to L-DOPA therapy. So we will say that this is an atypical Parkinson's disease. In Parkinson, progressive supranuclear palsy, there's a greater burden of tau. Tau protein will be present in greater amount in progressive supranuclear palsy in the brainstem and the deep gray matter, while in corticobasal degeneration, balance is shifted more towards the cerebral cortex involvement. And this can only be diagnosed on the basis of biopsy, isn't it? Otherwise, by clinical signs and symptoms, you can suspect that this patient is suffering from atypical Parkinson's syndrome. Morphologically, structurally, when you look under the microscope, you see brain shows cortical atrophy. Cerebral cortex atrophy will occur mainly of the motor, obviously associated with movements, pre-movements, and anterior parietal lobes. Okay, this histopathologist can tell, isn't it? In affected regions of the cortex, this is important, that structurally what changes will occur in this, there'll be severe loss of neurons and gliosis. Gliosis is the inflammation of the other substances of the brain supporting other than neurons. So there'll be loss of neurons, and there will also be inflammation of the glial cells. Glial cells are supporting cells of the brain other than neurons, and there'll be balloon neurons. And it is also known as neuronal achromasia. Okay, now tau immunoreactivity has been found in astrocytes, which are one of these cells, glial cells of the brain, isn't it? You must have read about astrocytes, they become a tuft astrocytes. And oligodendrocytes, which are also glial cells, they undergo inflammation and they have coiled bodies, and basal ganglionic neurons and cortex neurons. So these are the changes which occurs in atypical Parkinson's syndrome and corticobasal degeneration, that there'll be balloon neurons, which are known as neuronal achromasia. This is a name given to its neuronal achromasia. Then there'll be astrocytes, tuft astrocytes will be present. There'll be coiled bodies of the oligodendrocytes are present. Okay, cluster of tau positive processes around the astrocytes what happens is tau protein form clusters around the astrocyte, which is one of the glial cell, and they will form an astrocytic plaque. And presence of tau positive threads in gray and white matter will be present, which is seen in corticobasal degeneration. Substantia nigra and rocus cellulus will also show loss of pigmentation of the neurons because of the neuronal loss, neuronal achromasia, balloon neurons, and they will also show tangles, these areas of substantia nigra and locus. So these patients will also have Parkinson-like symptoms, but they will have other symptoms also. So we will, in other words, a patient is suffering from atypical Parkinson disease. Now, multisystem atrophy is another disease, degenerative disease of the brain, in which it is very rare disorder that affects several functions of the system in the brain. There are several functional systems of the brain and characterized by cytoplasmic inclusion of multiple system atrophy. Also, you will see cytoplasmic inclusion alpha synuclein, but in this case, in multiple system atrophy, you will see it in the oligodendrocytes, which are one of the glial cells in the brain. Okay. Now, multisystem atrophy refers to distinct neuroanatomic circuits that are commonly involved. Different circuits will be affected, which will produce different signs and symptoms. And what are those circuits? Striatonigral circuit, which leads to Parkinson-like symptoms in the patient. Oligopontocerebellar circuits, which leads to ataxia in patients who are suffering from multiple system atrophy. And autonomic nervous system will also be affected, leading to autonomic dysfunction with orthostatic hypotension. So in it's a very complicated disease, which involves different system circuits of the brain, that is, striatonigral system where circuit it will affect oligopontocerebellar circuit, and it will also affect the autonomic nervous system, leading to orthostatic hypotension. There's a detail given in Robbins, but we are not going to discuss now, otherwise it will take the whole hour to explain. Okay, now Huntington's disease. You must have heard the name. What is actually Huntington's disease? It is a degenerative disease. It is autosomal dominant disease. Degeneration of the striatal neurons will occur in Huntington's disease, resulting in the progressive movement disorders. There'll be difficulty in movement and dementia. Patient will suffer from dementia. They'll be jerky, hyperkinetic, increased movement, sometimes dystonic movement, involve all parts of the body. All the parts of the body will have jerky and hyperkinetic movement, which is also known as chorea, and are characterized by affected individual may later develop bradykinesia. Initially, they will have jerky and hyperkinetic increased movement, and later they will develop bradykinesia, that is slowing in the movement and rigidity of the body. Disease is progressive and fatal, and with an average course of about 15 years, patient will survive from average course of 15 years, and this is a fatal disease, Huntington disease, and it is the degenerative disease of the brain. It is an autosomal dominant disease, which involves the striatal neurons, resulting in the progressive movement disorders and dementia. Now, spinocerebellar degeneration, all these are the degenerative diseases. So spinocerebellar degeneration, what is spinocerebellar degenerative disease involving the cerebellum, as the name suggests, along with spinal cord. It is a degenerative disease which involves the spinal cord along with cerebellum and the peripheral nerves. This is highly heterogeneous. It is a group of disorder in which there'll be different clinical, genetic, and pathological levels with difference in the pattern of inheritance, age of onset. There's a group of diseases known as spinocerebellar. It includes a lot of diseases which have different clinical, genetic, and pathological levels with difference in the pattern of inheritance, age of onset, and clinical signs and symptoms. This is a full group of disorder. This is not a single disorder. Common across them is the presence of all of them. All of these spinocerebellar disorder is that they'll be, what is the common between them is presence of neuronal loss and often gliosis. There'll be loss of neurons, and there'll be inflammation of the glial cells of the brain in the affected area. Clinical symptom commonly include cerebellar and sensory ataxia, spasticity, and sensory motor peripheral neuropathy. These are the signs and symptoms which is common in all the patients who are suffering from different type of spinocerebellar degeneration. It's a group of disorder. Okay. Now, there's another disorder, degenerative disease, which is known as amyotrophic lateral sclerosis. It is a progressive disorder in which there's loss of upper motor neurons in the cerebral cortex and lower motor neurons in the spinal cord and the brainstem. Okay, and loss of these neurons results in denervation of the muscles. Those neurons who are innervating the muscle, there'll be denervation in these muscles, producing weakness of those muscles that become profound as the disease process progresses. Okay. Now, disease has an overall incidence of about 2 cases per 1,000. It is a very rare disease, affects men slightly more than women's and fifth decade or later. It occurs in 50s and later, and sporadic amyotrophic lateral sclerosis is more common than familial amyotrophic. So it is a very rare disease, and it, although familial causes, inherited cause, type of amyotrophic lateral sclerosis occurs, but sporadic amyotrophic lateral sclerosis is more common, and it's a rare disease because 2 cases per 100,000 population occurs. Okay, it is a progressive disorder in which loss of upper motor neurons in the cerebral cortex and loss of lower motor neurons in the spinal cord and brainstem occur. All these are given in detail in Dobbins. Okay, I'm just giving you a brief outline, and you have to learn by heart. It is a game of memory, actually. So thank you very much for your patient listening. So thank you very much. We have finished the lecture on time. Sorry for the delay.